Around the world, wealth is unevenly distributed. So if you look at wealth distributions in countries ranging from Nordics to the US, you see that the top 10% of the population, when you rank people according to wealth, owns more than half of total wealth. So this applies in countries like the Nordics, but also perhaps even more in countries like Germany, France, and the US. Why should we care about the distribution of wealth? Well, if you think about wealth itself, it's easy to see that wealth is important for households in many ways. Needless to say, wealth allows for better quality of life. But wealth also can act as a buffer in times of distress. So, for example, in times of unemployment and in cases of illness. Wealth also determines financial resources in retirement. So if you don't manage to save enough before you retire, your quality of life during retirement is, of course, going to be very low. And finally, wealth can also help us to help those who are depending on us, our children, and, for example, our elderly parents. So if wealth is important, and if the distribution of wealth is important, what determines wealth inequality? A simple accounting identity tells you that whatever you have today is going to depend on what you had yesterday, how much your wealth returned from yesterday up to today, and how much you managed to save from yesterday up to today. Understanding the determinants of wealth inequality has been subject to a lot of research lately in finance and economics. And evidence is now telling us that these returns actually play a perhaps surprisingly fundamental role. So let's illustrate the role of returns by looking at two people. Let's call them Sally and Bob. Sally owns risky assets and earns a return of 10% on average over time. Bob keeps everything in cash and earns nothing. Bob and Sally both are not saving at all, so we are shutting down the saving channel here. And Bob and Sally are in their 30s, so they are at the same stage in the life cycle. So let's assume the wealth distribution today is even. Sally owns 50%, Bob earns 50% of total wealth. The only difference between Sally and Bob is that Sally earns 10, whereas Bob earns nothing. Sally and Bob are in their 30s today. So what will they have, and what will the wealth distribution look like in 30 years' time? So they are today in their 30s, so in 30 years' time, they are pretty much going to retire. All right, so if we let that return difference of 10% do its job over 30 years, we're going to see a wealth distribution where Sally has 95% of wealth, whereas Bob only has 5%. Remember, Bob and Sally were similar. That's sort of the assumption we have made in this example. The only difference is the difference in returns. So this simple example tells you that returns can be incredibly powerful in generating wealth inequality. Here we go from an even wealth distribution to a very uneven wealth distribution. What if we start with an uneven wealth distribution? What if Sally has 90% and Bob has 10%. Let's 30 years do their job and see what happens to the wealth distribution. Sally will now have practically everything, Bob will have nothing. So we have here even more wealth inequality. Third example, What if Sally today has only 10% and Bob has 90%? Still, there is a difference in the returns between Sally and Bob of 10%. What will the wealth distribution look like in 30 years? Well, in this example, where Sally had less to begin with, you will see that returns will reduce wealth inequality. Sally will have 66, and Bob will have 34. Okay, so two key insights. Returns can be incredibly powerful in explaining wealth inequality. And second, how these dynamics actually work is going to depend on the initial wealth distribution. Okay. So what is the role of ownership here? Well, if you think about the returns that people earn on their wealth, that is going to directly depend on how households allocate their wealth. Between different asset classes, like real estate or cash, but also within asset classes, to different types of real estate and different types of other assets. Okay, so household returns will then depend on which assets people actually own. So if you want to understand wealth inequality, you need to look at returns. And to understand returns, you need to look at ownership. So ownership can potentially be an important driver of wealth inequality and its dynamics over time. So what do households actually own? So if you look at the median households in three Nordic countries, aggregated together, Sweden, Norway, and Finland. The approximate numbers look like this. The median household has 75% in real estate. The second most important asset class is cash, that features at 15%. Investments, so that includes stocks and mutual funds, that accounts for 8% of total wealth for the median household. And then we have business assets. So this would be entrepreneurs, small businesses, that accounts for 2% of the median household balance sheet. So ownership is going to be important for returns. So what do those returns actually look like? What sort of returns do households earn on these different asset classes? Again, looking at the median households in Sweden, Norway, and Finland, approximately the numbers look like this. Households earn about 6% every year on their real estate holdings. They earn only 1% on cash. They earn about 7% on their investments, so this is mutual funds and stocks. And then they earn about 11% on their business assets. Okay, so now combining these two facts, the allocation of assets between asset classes and the returns that people earn on these different asset classes, tells us that on average, households earn about 5% every year. Okay, so this is for the median household. So that 5% number, that median return, is calculated on asset holdings, so total assets. Like a firm, a household has a balance sheet. We have assets, but we also have liabilities. So the total returns that we earn are going to be determined by both the assets and liabilities. So if you take debt into account, you will see that the returns that households earn on net wealth are higher than that 5% number. So what this means is that many households are able to boost their returns by using leverage. Okay, what are we talking about? Well, in most cases, we're talking about mortgages. We're talking about the fact that people take a mortgage with a very low interest rate, and they invest that into real estate that earns a much higher interest rate. That boosts the returns of households. So not only asset allocation, but also leverage plays an important role. Okay, so if you think about that 5% number that we quoted earlier, that's for the median. However, the real point here is to go back to Sally and Bob. They had a different return. It is those differences in returns that might matter a lot for wealth inequality. So what do these differences look like in the real world? One important source of variation in returns is wealth itself. So here in this graph, we are plotting the returns that households earn along the wealth distribution. So if we start from the very bottom of the wealth distribution, so the bottom 20%, we see that households there earn about 2%. If we go up to the median household, the return is about 6%. And then if we move to the very, very top of the wealth distribution, so the very wealthiest households, there the return is almost 10%. So if you take the difference between the very wealthy and the median, that is about 4%. And now, going back to Sally and Bob had a difference of 10%. 4% is large enough to matter a lot for generating wealth inequality and also explaining dynamics of wealth inequality over time. Another source of variation in returns is your parents. So if you happen to have a parent who has a high return, you are also more likely to have a high return. Again, if you rank households according to their parents' returns, or here actually individuals' returns, individuals according to their parent returns, you see that at the very bottom, the returns are much lower than at the very top. So not only your wealth level, but also your parental sort of background matters for the returns that you earn on your wealth. So what prevents some people from earning higher returns? Okay, we would probably like most households to earn as much as possible. What makes that difficult for some households? Well, one reason is that people lack financial literacy. They don't understand even the most basic financial concepts. To do asset allocation effectively, you need to understand what are those assets to begin with. If you don't understand that, it's easy to see that you're not going to do asset allocation in the best possible way. Another reason is that we suffer from behavioral biases. These behavioral biases, for example, loss aversion and mental accounting, they might render some assets unattractive to us. So subjectively, we might think that investing in stocks is a bad idea, although objectively, we financial economists think that almost for everybody, it is a good idea. Okay? The third reason why people might not be earning high returns is that they have cultural attitudes that prevent them from utilizing the opportunities provided by financial markets. Some people might think having any debt in your balance sheet is a bad idea. Others might think the stock market is such an evil place that I don't want to have anything to do with that. So these are sort of three reasons why people might not be earning the highest possible return. So wealth inequality is high around the world. Evidence shows that returns vary greatly in the population. They increase in wealth, and they increase in parents' returns. So returns, and thus ultimately ownership, is a fundamental driver of wealth inequality. So what can you do to improve your returns? If you want to be more like Sally in terms of returns than Bob, what can you do? Well, first of all, you should consider investing in assets that earn higher returns. So for example, investing some of your money to stocks and mutual funds makes a lot of sense. You should diversify because this makes your returns more stable over time and helps you more reliably to climb in the wealth distribution. You should lever up, because we saw that many households are boosting their returns by using leverage. And finally, you should definitely look out for costs. costs can easily wipe out any additional returns. So thinking about costs of mutual funds, cost of structured products, or the interest rates that you are paying on, for example, consumer loans, can matter a great deal. Thank you.